Good afternoon. Happy Sabbath. Let's kneel for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, again we come before you this day. We ask your Spirit be here with us. It is so very important, Father, that we are not going by the sparks of our own kindling, Father, but that your lamp light our path for our feet. Be with us. Help us to get this work done, Lord, so we can go home and see how beautiful heaven must be. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're looking at the situation with the woman at the well. And we know that Jesus had made it a spiritual issue, meaning we can apply this to the church too, because he did that. And we saw the exchange going back and forth. And a couple of times, a racial element could have entered into it, but it wasn't racism, it was prejudice, not racism. Racism, by definition, cannot exist on this planet. Why? There's only one race. There ever has been, that's it. That's it. One race. So this division that is created is not from the Lord. Who's it from? It's prejudice, absolutely, but not racism. Even evolutionists can't claim that, because if you came from a monkey, there's one race, one line, one bloodline. That's it. But we know that here there's only one bloodline. If you're a Christian and you claim your racism, then you don't know your scripture at all. Prejudice? Yes. And we're dealing with prejudice here because what was a Samaritan? What were they? What were the Pharisees? I've heard many times this being referred to as racism. It can't be, because they claimed, who was their father? The Samaritans? Jacob, whose great-grandson was he? Abraham. And who did the Jews claim the Pharisees, as their father? So what did that make them? See, it's prejudice. It was a worship issue, wasn't it? And that's what Jesus was overcoming. He sent the disciples away. They didn't even know it, that they were sent away, because he wanted to deal with this woman with getting that out. Two times the woman brought up the prejudice issue, two times Jesus ignored it or overrode it. However, when it came to the issue of worship, Jesus addressed it. And I want to focus in on the one thing that he said to her. And we're going to come down to verse 21 of chapter 4 in the book of John. Jesus said unto her, "Woman, believe me, the hour comes when you shall neither worship in the mountain, in this mountain, nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour comes, and now is, when true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father seeks such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth." Now, what is Jesus talking about here? What does all this mean? Well, we're going to, you know, I got to tell you something. This addresses every issue in the Bible. This one statement here. starts in the Garden of Eden and ends in the book of Revelation. What does it mean to worship the Father in spirit and in truth? He establishes you're worshiping what you do not know. You can apply that to apostate Protestantism, Roman Catholicism, paganism, whatever you want. You don't know what you're worshiping. But the Jews, and now you'll notice Jesus referred to him and them as what? The Jews. Because he's relating to the woman, because there's a prejudice there from Samaritan to Jew. There's a prejudice. She didn't consider herself a Jew, did she? What did she consider herself? Samaritan. So there was a big riff. But were they all Jews? Exactly. Not proper Jews. Same thing on this planet. Same thing on this planet. We are all of one race. If you are a Christian and you think otherwise, you need to re-educate yourself on that. Came from one place. My house shall be a house of prayer unto certain people or unto all. Isn't that what the Bible says? Let us make man in our what? Where was there another image? Must be an idol in there somewheres. Because there's only one image. One God, one Jesus, one Holy Spirit. I want to read out of 7a, the commentaries. Mrs. White is talking about, and this commentary is just in regards to worship and truth and spirit. She says, the Jews, after their long captivity, would not make any image. The image on the Roman ensign or banner they called an abomination, especially when these emblems were placed in a prominent place for them to respect. Such respect they regarded as a violation of the second commandment. When the Roman ensign was set up in the holy place in the temple, they looked upon it as an abomination. Now, what period of time is this addressing? There's only one time when the Romans were involved in the temple. I mean, just the fact they were Roman and temple. What time would that be? Time of Christ. When the Herod's temple was built, so-called. What happened in Herod's with that temple? See, the Romans had standing orders that you could not tear down any old structure, you see, without them giving their permission. They didn't want the temple, and Herod wanted to rebuild the temple because Herod was a builder. A lot of people don't know that. Herod loved to build things. He built fortresses. He built a city on a mountain. He built a lot of things. He wasn't just a murderer. Herod thought, of course, he was building it for what reason? Just like the Egyptians built their things, it was praise to him. So he wanted to rebuild the temple. So what he actually did, instead of tearing it down, he built a temple around it, pretty much. But guess where a lot of the materials came from? The Romans. Because he coerced them into, you know, well, your glory can go into this too. So they were given this, given that, but then they had to be recognized. So guess what was in the temple? Do we see that today? Do we see Rome's emblems in the Seventh-day Adventist Church? You better believe it. At the GC meetings, their flags are there. Now their priests are talking. Isn't that interesting? What happened to that temple? It was... Yes, Nellie, it was burnt. It was destroyed, and the gold ran down the street, didn't it? The fire was so... Even though Titus tried to stop it, his soldiers just tore it to pieces because the Lord said that's what's going to happen to that temple. So now we see a worship issue coming in here. So when she says that the Jews would not make an image, this is not talking about which era of time. Because when they came out of captivity from Egypt, what was the first thing they did? they made a golden calf. So this is talking about simply the mention of the Roman and the temple the first century. This is talking about the first century Seventh-day Adventist church. They were so careful not to make any images. Why were they doing sitting on a well? That was the center of worship. You see the problem? Our father Jacob, but then they had their father Abraham, not God. To make an image of God dishonors him. No one should bring into service the power of imagination to worship that which belittles God in the mind and associates him with common things. Now, isn't that interesting? Now we're kind of getting away from graven images, aren't we? Those who worship God must worship him in spirit and truth. They must exercise living faith. Their worship will then be controlled not by the imagination, but by genuine faith. That's the danger of big fancy churches, folks. That's the danger of fancy speakers. That's the danger of all this artificial intelligence. What happens? The Roman ensign is in the church, you see. The Roman insignia is in the church. See the problem? Doesn't have to be a fat little Buddha. It doesn't have to be a crucifix. Let men worship and serve the Lord God and him only. Let no selfish pride be lifted up and served as a god. Let not money be made a god. If sensuality is not kept under the control of the higher powers of the mind, base passion will rule the being. Anything that is made the subject of undue thought and admiration absorbing the mind is a god before the Lord. Now do you know why the five virgins had no oil in their lamps? Does that make sense? Because what did they do? They replaced God with whatever. You don't need a little statue. You don't need the Pope. Your local preacher, your local Sabbath school teacher can be your idol. Your technology can be your idol. It really bothers me, and you know, I know I'm going to get blowback from this, to see all this technology in these churches. Screens and this and that and the other thing. What's wrong with just talking about the Bible? What's wrong with that? You know, it's amazing because when Jesus went and preached, he didn't even have a Bible in front of him because he didn't have one. How about the apostles? What Bible did they have? What books were they opening? It was right here. What laptop did they have? It was right here. Ever before their mind. See, the problem with that is, when you close the book, what do? When you close the computer, what do? What is your mind then absorbed with? They are those who followed the Lamb wheresoever he went. You have to be paying attention to keep up with Jesus. I tell you, the disciples were with him. How long? How long were they with Jesus? How many years? Isn't that interesting? Did they get it? Jesus said, there are many things I wish to tell you, but I cannot. Peter said, oh no, you're not going to be crucified. And Jesus said, get behind me. He wasn't talking to Peter. Who was he talking to? Who was standing right there in the midst. And they didn't know it. Only one knew that the devil was right there. Because, you see, the disciples had their idols. Who were their idols? What was their idol? What did they say in Matthew 23 to Jesus? At the end of Matthew 23. They were stymied that Jesus went in the temple and he said what he said in Matthew 23 to the rulers of the temple. Well, and they were speechless. Even Peter. And then when they came out and they went up on Olivet, what did they say to Jesus about the temple? Remember? They got a lot more than they asked for. What was their idol? The temple. Because why? They thought salvation was there. But they didn't hear Jesus say to the woman at the well, they didn't hear him say, the day is coming when the temple will not be a place for worship either. Although, they did hear it in Matthew 23, when he said to them, your house is left to you desolate. That resounded in their minds. They knew what that meant. Never referred to it as not his father's house up until that point. And they were speechless, stymied. What's going to happen to the temple? You see the building, he said. And then he went on. Did he stop with the destruction of the temple? Right down to the second coming in Matthew 24. They had other idols. And in his patience, you see, you know, the interesting thing is, folks, do you know what Gethsemane means? You know what it means? Translated, oil press. Oil press. Why is that significant? What happened at Gethsemane? Why is that significant? Why does it mean oil press? Why did Jesus go there? There were many other places he could have gone. It wasn't the only place he went to be alone, was it? It means oil press because what got pressed out of Christ when he went there? Holy Spirit, right out of him. When did that happen and why? It happened because, number one, the Holy Spirit cannot dwell where there is what? Sin. Willful, wanton sin. What did Jesus do in Gethsemane? When he started sweating blood, the Holy Spirit was coming out of him. He took on our iniquities. We're going to look at that word later. So, he took on this sin for just me? For just you? Does anybody have any idea how many people lived? We have no idea. Billions and billions of people. We can't comprehend that. Now, was that man that took that or was that God that took that? You better believe it was God, because no man could take that. Though he were man, he were God. Though he were God, he were man. This is the mystery, folks. It had to be one equal with the law, Mrs. White says, to do what? To pay the price of the law. Couldn't have been an angel. Couldn't have been an individual. It had to be a God. The God. So who suffered in Gethsemane, by the way? Was it just Jesus Christ? Or was it the Father and the Holy Spirit were suffering right along with him? The oil was being pressed out of him. You see, oil press, Gethsemane. What did they do at Gethsemane? They pressed the olives and made oil. You see? So, he said, I'm not reading, I'm looking. The prince of this world comes and what? He has nothing in me. Therefore, and now I can stand. We have to be in that same condition. So to worship him in truth and spirit, who's the him here, by the way? The Father. To worship him in truth, Jesus is what? The truth. And of course, we know about the Spirit. That's our intelligence, by the way. You want artificial intelligence? Fine, you're going to give up the Holy Spirit. Oh, I know. I'm going to hear about that statement too. You can't have both. It's either God's wisdom or whose? Satan's. We like to say man. Satan's. Where did Satan lead man to? Where did he lead him to? Death. Without exception, death. But wait. The Father said, I'm going to send my only begotten Son, which John called what? What did he call Jesus? What did he call Jesus? He distinctly called him something other than Jesus. In the beginning was the... And the Word did what? He sent his law, his character, his mind embodied in flesh and blood to uphold the truth. When the weight was put on him, where were we? What were we doing? We were sleeping, you see. The new church was laying on the ground sleeping. And the Father had to send angels to comfort him because his closest companion, who he was with, how long? 3.5 years, had no clue what was happening. Now, would you call these men Christ's, would you call Christ these men's mentor? I would. Because it took some fire to get their attention. What do you think it's going to take to get my attention? I have not been in Christ's presence for 3.5 years, although I've had the opportunity to. But you see, when I close the Bible, when I close the book, I have other things to do. My mind is full. Did the disciples have anything else to do when they were with Jesus for three? How come they didn't get it? Well, I'll tell you this much. They got it to the point where they knew they had to follow him. Much more than I do. So before you criticize them, be careful. What did Peter leave? Well, what about his business? What about John? James, what did they do? What about Matthew? We know John and we're fishermen too. They had a business. What about Matthew? What did he leave? He had a very good job. And on and on and on. Have I done that? No. So how dare I criticize them? Because when I close this book, I go to my other interests. The man said, Lord, I'll follow you, but blah, 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 blah. He said, Jesus said, birds have a nest, foxes have a burrow, but what? Son of man has no place to lay his head. You're going to follow me? What was he telling him? What was he telling me? Forget that guy. That guy lived 2,000 years ago. I have no idea who he was. Do you? I don't know what he was into. Do you? But he was talking to me in that statement. But you see, when I close the book, I leave him and that guy there. Because that guy's not me. I'm following Christ in truth and spirit, really? I don't think so. Does that mean that we do not provide for our families? Absolutely, we do. That's our number one priority biblically. Did you know that? Not doing this work, not doing that work, but providing for our family. Did God provide for his? Is there an example of that? Of course there is. What did he make before he made Adam and Eve? What did he make? See, that's another problem with evolution. There's no provision. But what did he make? He made a totally desolate planet. He took and made it a beautiful home, one that we can't even imagine was so beautiful. He filled it with companions, whether animal, and he filled it with food. He filled it with water. And then what did he do? He made Adam. But then he made Adam realize that he needed a companion. Then what did he do? He made Eve. He didn't just give her to him for granted. No, you need to realize you need help. So, we need not to have anything in this world. Again, it doesn't mean we forsake everything. We have responsibilities. It doesn't mean that I tomorrow don't go, or, well, I don't have to work tomorrow, but Monday I don't go to work. It doesn't mean that. But when I do go to work, who goes with me? Who do I take? See, that's got to be my choice. The Holy Spirit. Do I conduct myself and my affairs according to the Scripture? Or when I close the book, did that stop? Like Hilda said, I never told her about the Sabbath. How does she know that? Because she observes you. You see? In the beginning was the Word. And the Word, where to be the Word too, folks? Where to be the Word too? In our sphere. Rodney said this morning during a Sabbath school, an excellent discussion about the Holy Spirit, we have to live up to all the light that we have. Then we are perfect. And for each one of us, that's different. Then the Word is doing what in us? It's living in us. Who animates that in us? The Holy Spirit. So we can't have any other idols. We can't have any other gods. We like to look at people who do these things and frown upon them. But what are we doing? You see, because we're held to a higher standard. Did you know that? We'll be held to a higher standard because we claim to be who? Christ's brothers and sisters. On a physical or a spiritual level? On a spiritual level. So, said anything that is made the subject of undue thought and admiration, absorbing the mind, is a god chosen before the Lord. God is a searcher of the mind. She says heart, but in this English, that's what that means. And I specify that because today everything's emotion. This is logic and common sense and thinking. He distinguishes between true heart service and idolatry. So we don't need to have a statue, do we? Per se. We can be our own idol, can't we? Let's take a look at this in action. Let's go to Genesis 4. Let's go to Genesis 4. You know what's amazing to me, folks? The more I listen to even Seventh-day Adventism, am I going to save this? No, I'll talk about this later. Let's talk about this. If I get there, if not, fine. I'll pick it up another day. What is the story we're going to look at in Genesis 4? Everybody knows it. Cain and Abel. Do we see a conflict between what we're talking about, between these two? You better believe it. You better believe it. You can even go back to the Garden of Eden. Was Adam worshiping Jesus in truth, or God in truth and spirit? Not when he took a bite out of that apple, he wasn't. Well, who was he worshiping then? Eve. Was Eve worshiping God in truth and spirit when she let herself be fooled into... What was she worshiping then? The created, not the creator. Were they warned about that situation? And boy, did they pay a heavy price. Because this was an extremely heavy price that Adam and Eve took to their graves. Cain and Abel. Let's take a look at this situation. And you know, folks, you can say Cain and Abel, or you can really bring it up to today and say people in the church. You see? Because if you look at Cain and Abel and you look at the Samaritans and Jews, is it the same situation? You better believe it. Did they have two different styles of worship? Was one right and one wrong? Is it not the same story? Were they not killing each other? Well, the story that Jesus told about the Good Samaritan, the Jews were perfectly willing to let that man die. Weren't they? I don't know if the man was a... Well, he was... It doesn't say whether the man was a Samaritan or not, does it? That was... beat, wounded, I don't know. What? Yeah, the one that was injured, we don't know. Was he a Jew? I don't know. I'd have to read the story again. My memory's... So, anyhow, the point is, it was just the foulest thing in the world that this Samaritan should show the kindness that the others did not, or the Christ-likeness that the holy men did not. That was a great contention. Jesus really took his life in his hands telling that story in the midst of those Jews. Think he did not, you better think again. Let's bring it up to today. Could you go into a crowd of people, certain different kinds of people, tell stories, and maybe not walk out of there with your life? You don't think that's possible to go down in Orlando and get in that kind of trouble today? You better believe it. especially if it's the truth. You've never been in a bad situation where you've got prejudice and so-called racial issues flaring. You can lose your life very quickly in that situation. And the people that take it wouldn't even know why 10 minutes after. You see? Just rage. As what happened here with this story. So you could say and put in here all these contentious issues that exist today. The Bible happens to say Cain and Abel. Because you know what? At that time, that was the issue. What's the issue today? Dealing with worship styles and types. Actually, it's far more relative today because there was only one back then, wasn't there? Well, after this, there were a couple different ones. Moses records here, let me see, where are we going to start? It's not that long of a story. Adam and Eve, verse 3. And in process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought a fruit of the ground, an offering unto the Lord. And Abel, he also brought of the fatling of his flock, and of the fat thereof, and the Lord had respect unto Abel and his offering. But unto Cain and to his offspring, or offering, he had no respect. And Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. And the Lord said to Cain, why are you angry? And why is your countenance fallen? If you do well, shalt thou not be accepted? And if thou dost not do well, sin lies at your door, and unto thee shall be his desire, and thou shalt rule over him. What's the issue here? Is there truth in spirit? Well, on Abel's part, there absolutely is. What is he doing? What is Abel doing? Exactly what the law demands, what the Lord said. He's not changing anything. He's doing what the... But what is Cain doing? He wants to worship the Lord, right? Is Cain disputing the fact that the Lord must be worshipped? No. But Cain is saying, I'm going to do it my way. Is there an idol there at this point? You better believe it. What's the idol? Cain's will. Cain's saying, you know what? What's the difference? I grow fruits and vegetables. That's got to be good enough for the Lord. It's the best I have. So Abel brings a sheep, brings whatever. It says the firstlings of his flock. The Lord should accept my offering. Who is dictating to who there? They're both Seventh-day Adventists. Aren't they? The Lord looks at... You'll notice that's capital letters, Lord, too. L caps, right? Who is that? Who is that? What would that name be translated out of? That's Creator God. He smells the savor, right? He smells the sacrifice, and he's pleased. So he says to Abel, well done. But to Cain, Cain gets angry. This is always the outcome. Why is not my offering accepted? Why is not what I do accepted? Why are not my words accepted? So what does Cain do? The Lord goes, he's trying to reason with him. And the Lord said unto Cain, why are you angry? And why is your attitude changed so badly? He's doing his own way. He's asking him, what is your problem? You know you're not doing the right thing. He's speaking to him. He's speaking to him. And what does he say? And he says, if you do well, you're accepted. You know that. But if you do not, then the devil will master you. The enemy will take control of you. Cain was so bent on being selfish, what was he willing to do? Object lesson, folks. What was he, did he doubt God? No. But he was so bent on doing his own thing, just like Lucifer. What was he willing to do? Let the devil take control of him. And I tell you, it's the same thing in the church. I tell you, it was the same situation with the Samaritans and the Jews. Their pride, their tradition, their arrogance. Because there was no racism. It was prejudice. Cain killed his brother, who God had just said has done well. Wow. Think about that. So why did Cain kill Abel? What was the true motive? Did he hate his brother? No. But he hate what his brother stood for. You sided with God against me. In essence, that's what he said. So out in the field, what did he do? They got in a discussion, read on. They got in an argument. Passion took control, emotion, and what did he do? And he didn't even have the character or backbone to admit it, did he? Does it ever say in there, in the narrative that Moses wrote through the Holy Spirit? Because as we talked about in Sabbath school, that this is an anointed book, right? Yes, I killed my brother. Did he ever say that? No, doesn't come out. God tells him he killed his brother. Now, let's look at the difference between his attitude and Adam and Eve. Who told you you were naked? They kept passing the buck. They couldn't pass it. Finally, they submitted. You see, Cain never did. Cain never did. Isn't that interesting? It's sad, actually. Cain would not admit that he did wrong. If Cain had admitted he did wrong and repented, would there have been forgiveness for him? Yes, he would have had to pay a price for it. But he had no peace the rest of his life, because what else does it say in there that tells us that this man had no peace? The Lord said, I'm going to put a mark on you. And what did Cain reply? This is too much for any man to bear. Cain's people went out and became, and I hear the stuff from the so-called intellectuals about this is why the Bible is bogus. Where did the other people come from? Blah, 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 blah. I don't know. Doesn't matter. But there is great evidence that pre-flood, there was a lot of people on this planet. I don't know. I've heard Seventh-day Adventists doubt the Bible because of this narrative. Don't know. Quite frankly, I don't care. This will be answered in due time. It's not important for me to know because it's not here. And this is another object lesson test. I believe, my opinion, that God left that like that because it's a point to doubt on. And it's found great root. And it's definitely not a salvation issue, as Miss Nellie said. Because you know what? I don't know where Adam and Eve came from, do you? I mean, it tells us, but I don't know how that happened, do you? I find that much more harder to believe than where did the other people come from? Because two people came from nothing. Think about it. They don't have a problem with that. So, I don't know, and I'm not even going to venture to guess. I don't care. It's not important. What's important is the attitude here. What's important is where's the truth and spirit here. What's important is the big idol that Cain made, and the idol, by the way, was a mirror. Because who was his idol? himself. Who is Lucifer's idol? That same mirror. Only he's dead, Cain, and Lucifer and Satan's still alive, wreaking havoc. Not for long. You know, I thought about that the other day, Rodney. You see, in the Sanhedrin, when they took a vote, how did they do it? How did the vote go in the Sanhedrin amongst the members? What I mean by that is there were older and younger members. How did the vote go when they took a vote? Do you know? The younger members would cast their votes first. And that would be made known. Do you know why? Then the older members would vote. Do you know why? What did you say, Nellie? Well, they knew how they vote, but also the younger members couldn't be puppets of the older members, could they? They had a vote. God thought of everything. They had a vote their own mind. And they couldn't be influenced by how the older members were voting who had more experience. See, today we do it backwards. In America, the portion of our society with the least amount of knowledge and experience gets heard the most. Have you ever thought about that? What do college kids know about anything? They know nothing. For all that matters, what do college professors know about it? They've never had a real job. They've lived in that bubble all their life. All due respect. None of them can go out and run businesses. Because I see their models, I say very few of them. Okay? So who do we go to? Who does Rome use for opinion? People that haven't a clue. Nowadays, they don't work. They don't produce their own money. They don't take care of themselves. So what do they know? You see, in the society that Jesus set up, the younger people were students of the older people. That's where all your knowledge and wisdom is. And going back to what I was saying, we live, what, 80 years? And poof. We're gone. To Adam, what is 80 years? That's a cut on a finger. To Lucifer, who, I don't know, does anybody here know how long he's been in existence? What is 6,000 years? Poof. Nothing. Think about that. Because you see, that's how smart we aren't. Oh, he's had 6,000. I don't know if he's lived 6 million years or billion years. And you know, that's ridiculous. That's because that's the way we're taught to think. I don't know how long he's been in existence. Do you? I don't know how long God's been in existence. Do you? Could be a number. We don't even have a number for. I don't know. And every time they take a look at the universe, it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. You think that happened in one day? I have no idea how long he's been around. But I suspect he was one of the first angels. Why was he in charge? What? Do you make, and that's not the way God works, do you make all the body of angels and nobody to lead them? Or do you make the leader first? How does God work? The solution is there before the situation is, always. So, by that logic, Lucifer was one of the first, one of the most experienced. He's seen who knows how many societies and worlds created. What is 6,000, 7,000, 10,000 years to him? Nothing. It's as James says, we're but a mist that appears for a second. Same thing with him. Maybe, you know what? He's but a mist that appeared for half a second. Because to us, somebody who's 100 years old is ancient. You know that back in Adam's day, in the antediluvian's time, that was still a youth? 300 years before they considered them to be starting adulthood. Did you ever read that? Well, Mrs. White says. Makes sense. So today we take somebody who's 18, 20 years old and they're an authority. On what? How to suck on a baby bottle? Because I see them walking around doing that today. How did that get so twisted? And whose work do you think that is? How can you worship God in truth and in spirit if you have no experience with God? How can you worship God in truth and in spirit if you're getting all your information from artificial intelligence? That in of itself to me, and I'm probably using this wrong, but I'm going to say, is an oxymoron. There's only one intelligence. And where does that come from? I'm not saying, folks, that these things are wrong, and they can be great tools, especially for somebody like Bill or people who travel. They don't have to carry all this stuff. They got a little USB stick and a little bag with a computer. That's great. However, I can't have my books corrupted if I'm not getting them offline, can they? You can't take a Spirit of Prophecy book and change it. And I've been through this before because in Adventism, oh, don't read that book. It's been changed. It can't be changed legally. Why? Why can I not take this book right here, first volume of the testimonies, and rewrite it and change it? Why? Copyright laws? Do you think that the people that hold those copyright laws are going to go along with that? No. But I can go online and tweak it. I can write a new book, which the conference did, and call it The Great Controversy, but they can't change not one of the three versions of the old Great Controversy. Did they attempt to do that? No, they couldn't. There's copyright. Not only that, but how many copies of the old ones are out there? Then how long do you think it's going to take before they start to say, wait a minute, you changed this. But you know what? I can do it on a computer and there's nothing. Nothing can be done about it. That's the problem with artificial intelligence, you see? So, and again, the people that use these things need to make sure they're pure. And there's a reason why the Lord allows these things to happen, folks. He wants us to search and search and search. When we close the laptop, when we close the book, when we close the Bible, it's not to stay there, it's to be here. That's why study, 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 study. What did Peter say about people that do that? Some study to their own what? How about you go out and put it into principle and into work, into action? What about that? And I've said this, and boy, I get a lot of rebuke, especially from preachers and ministers. Jesus spent time studying, yes, but the Bible records more him praying and doing. Did it say that he retired to the mountain to his Spirit of Prophecy books to prepare his next sermon? Where is that? Is that what it says? When was he educated? By the age of 12 years old, he knew everything there was to know about him. How do we know that? When did he realize what his fate was, folks? On his way to Jerusalem to go to the Passover, when he saw the crucified people that the Romans put along the road, what did he realize? That was his lot. And then what was he doing after that? He was in the temple doing what? Teaching the teachers. At 12 years old. I'm not saying we shouldn't study and read. But we have made an idol out of this. It's absolutely necessary. But when are we going to put it into action? This has always been a problem for me, and I told Rita this with Seventh Day. I want to run here and hear this one. They want to go here and hear that one. They want to hear this one. This one's the... Well, what are you doing? A royal holy priesthood? What are you doing? Why do you not know these things? And I hold myself to that same standard. There comes a point in time. The disciples, for 3.5 years, and as we were talking about, were mentored. But did they get it? They had to stand on their own, and it took some fire to do that. were their own, being led by the Holy Spirit, to worship him in truth and in spirit. And everything that happened in those three and a half years came to their memory constantly. And then they got it. Now, that's why Jesus did that. That's why he said this. And they put it into practice. That was their education. That was their university. So much that John recorded new Christians. What did he refer to them as? In his epistle, in his letters? Little children. Many are stumped thinking he's talking to kindergartners. No, he's talking to new Christians. Because John felt that way after he realized what Christ was trying to teach him that. He was like a little child around Jesus. He knew nothing. Then he had to go out and live it. Then the education kicked in, didn't it? Paid in dividends, as they said. But you know what? They had to pay something. We didn't get very far there with Cain and Abel, but you get the idea. It's the same situation. The woman at the well, Cain and Abel, Eve, Adam. You go on and on and on. It's the same situation. Worship him in truth and in spirit. What is your idol in your life? Who is your idol? What is standing between me and worshiping the Father in truth and in spirit? That I have to answer. And you know what? There's only one person that can answer that question in the whole universe. Who is that? Me. The Holy Spirit will bring it to our attention. But like Cain, we can either ignore it, never admit. Did he admit? No. Or we can be satisfied with accepting the devil, which is what he did, or what the church will do. Or we can be conformed and molded and grow and grow and grow and attain to the highest level we can in this form that we're in. As Rodney said, as is common knowledge, we are held responsible for the light that we have or what? Could have gained. Ooh, that's a little twist, isn't it? How much light can we gain? As much as we want. So, we have to learn how to blend being a Seventh-day Adventist with being a husband, father, a parent, a mother, on the level that God had planned it to be, to take care of our responsibilities secularly and spiritually. We can't leave one undone and not the other, because then we have an idol. I hear so many people, oh, I don't have time, my family, blah, blah. Well, then you need to make some adjustments. Get a smaller house. Don't go on so many vacations. Don't buy new cars. I'm tired. Yeah, well, you know, that's part of it. Jesus was tired 24/7. Part of it. You're going to sleep soon. Don't worry about that. It's amazing. The same people will go out and go on vacation and run themselves into the ground to where when they come back, they can't even go to work. But yet, when it comes to working for Christ, I'm tired. Who's your idol? What's your idol? How many Seventh-day Adventists today are going to go to church, maybe eat, maybe not, and then go home and go to sleep? Because they had a long, hard week. Really? You tell God that in the day. You tell God that you were tired. Was Jesus ever rested? Yes. It records one time. When was that? After they killed him. And he rested in the what? On the Sabbath. You realize that's the only time it's there that I'm aware of in the Gospels? That Jesus rested? Because from his birth to that time, he was either hunted, questioned, scorned, chased, whatever you want. They wanted to throw him off a cliff, for Pete's sake. The only time that I can find, and maybe I'm wrong, somebody correct me, please, that he rested What does the word say? And he rested on the Sabbath according to the commandment. He was in a grave. He had no choice. So tell me about how tired you are. Of course, you'll get the argument. Oh, but it was Sabbath and he was resting. He was dead. He was dead. Because I can show you other Sabbaths where he was being chastised, argued with, and accused of being the devil. But that Sabbath he rested because he was dead. Amazing. So when should we rest? If he's our example in all things, when is our rest period as human beings here? When we die? They call it a sleep. You're saying, oh, Paul, that is real extreme. Oh, no, that's the example that's in the Bible. I have to gauge my life according to his. I don't know about you. And I have a real hard time doing that because I always get in the way. I always have an excuse. One that he never used. And after the apostles, we became apostles, they never used that. Where does it say they rested? Paul, I guess, rested when he got thrown in prison. I don't know. He wrote most of what he wrote in prison. Well, one of the easiest times he had was when the Romans gave him a house. And he was under house arrest. I don't know. But, you know, when you think about these things, what is our idol? How do we worship it? What is Jesus saying to this, to us, to the church? Worship in truth and in spirit. No man can get, or woman can get, in the way of that. And we have to look at that. If the church is to be a pure bride, there is no rest. We're the church militant. We're to be at war. We're on the front lines up until the second coming. And bullets and bombs and rockets will be coming our way. Specially made for us. But you know what? The armor that we're given, guess what? None of them can penetrate it unless we say, here, hit me here. I'm going to take this off. That's what Cain did. Here, shoot me here, devil. I'm standing here. That's what he did. Anyhow, let's pray. Heavenly Father, again, Lord, we come before you on this Sabbath day. We thank you for your wonderful blessings. We thank you again for the simplicity of your word and the directness of your Son, Lord, in teaching us what we must learn. We know nothing except how to whine and complain. Father, help us to be part of the solution and not the problem. Be with your people this Sabbath day, and help us to break that mirror of pride, Father, and rather put on a cloak of humility. Help us, Lord, to worship you in truth and in spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.